This audiobook was created using text-to-speech software, and was not read by a real person. Please keep in mind the limitations of the technology when it comes to pacing and pronunciation. Also, if you enjoy the audiobooks we create, please consider supporting the expense of our projects through our Patreon page. Those who do so have access to exclusive book series, are able to download the MP3 files for all books we create, and also have early access to our normal YouTube releases. For more details, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and we hope you enjoy the story. The Goonies. Written by James Caan. Based on the story by Steven Spielberg, and screenplay by Chris Columbus. Preview. It's summer in the small seaport town of Astoria, and a group of neighborhood kids, who call themselves the Goonies, are bored and restless. And worse yet, big developers are threatening to take over the town. When Mikey finds an old pirate map, the kids take off to find the treasures that can save their neighborhood. Take the oath. Join the adventure. I will never betray my goondock friends. We will stick together, until the whole world ends. Through heaven and hell, and nuclear war. Good pals like us, will stick like tar. In the city, or the country, or the forest, or the boonies. I am proudly declared, a fellow Goonie. The Goonie Oath. Prologue. Astoria Evening Standard, Saturday, October 24th. In a daring daylight escape this morning, convicted armed robber Jake Fratelli broke out of state prison and fled to a waiting getaway car. Fratelli, 33, apparently faked his own suicide while the other inmates were at breakfast, and when the guard entered his cell to cut the body down from where it was seemingly hanging by the neck, Fratelli knocked him unconscious, exchanged clothes with him, and simply walked out of the moderate security facility. According to guard Emil Yonis, he looked dead as a jackrabbit road kill to me, hangman's noose, and his tongue stuck out. But when I went to check him, I saw it was just a harness around his waist. That's when he nailed me. Yonis has been hospitalized for observation. Moments after Fratelli left the compound, the guard's naked body was discovered, and the alarm sounded. Prison guards gave chase, but a black off-road vehicle was waiting for the escapee just opposite a hill adjacent to the penitentiary. Driving the vehicle was the prisoner's mother, 56-year-old Mama Fratelli, herself a fugitive, and the prisoner's brother, Francis, 31, currently sought for questioning following a string of arsons last winter in Portland. The escape had obviously been well planned. As Jake approached the waiting vehicle, Francis lit a long stream of gasoline that had been poured 20 yards from the car, creating a wall of flame that effectively cut off immediate pursuit. Police were notified, however. As authorities closed in, the escape vehicle was seen again on Route 27 near Hillside, and a high-speed chase ensued, leading across the waterfront area, past the high school, through the municipal waste disposal area, around the marina, and finally, with a stroke of precision bravado by the Fratellis, into the midst of a cross-country race of over 50 other off-road vehicles. It was in the confusion of this camouflage that the Fratellis made their escape. There were no license plates on the vehicle, but it can be easily recognized by the numerous police bullet holes in its side. It was last seen heading north toward Janesville, although there are now reports of a similar vehicle sighted near Fresno. Prison officials now are conducting an investigation into security procedures at their facility. Guard Emil Yonis has been placed on inactive duty, pending the results of this inquiry. The Fratellis are armed and considered dangerous.
Chapter 1. So, my name is Mikey Walsh. Michael, actually, except nobody ever calls me that but Grandpa, when he can remember who I am at all. Mostly he just lies in the hammock in the backyard remembering when he was 13. That's what I am. 13. Short for my age, though. Not like a midget or anything, and I'm no chicken, but on the other hand, you're not going to find me in the parking lot after a football game with Glen Oaks West waiting to mix it up with those trolls. Bran calls me a wimp. He's my brother. I'm not, though. A wimp, I mean. I've just got better things to do than hoot about who creamed who at the game. Adventures are my game, even though they're usually pretty hard to come by in a junky little town like this. Bran says it's not that I'm short for my age, it's that I'm short for my size. He cracks himself up with that one. Mom just says I'm slight. I know what they're talking about, though. It's about how I'm not on any of the teams like Bran is, and I've got braces and asthma, and I get colds a lot, more than most of the other kids, especially in the fall. Fall is when this story all happened, but I'll get to that in a minute. Actually, October's my favorite month, even though Mom freaks out about flu season and my condition and stuff. October's great for leaves, though. They get these dynamite colors and fall off, and I get to rake them into piles to burn, and it's the greatest smell. Of course, it rains a lot, too. But when it doesn't, there's this special, mysterious kind of wind that seems to come out of the earth and go right through me, like through my heart or something. I mean, I know it doesn't, but that's how it seems. Kind of old-time magic. And, of course, Halloween's in October. So I love the fall. What I hate is my braces, especially when Dr. Hoffman tightens them once a month to correct my malocclusion, which is like an execution done about as slow as marshmallow taffy. Also, once when I kissed Cheryl Hagedorn, actually she kissed me, our braces locked, so we were like joined at the mouth, it was really a gross out, and I had to unhook us with her eyebrow tweezers in the rearview mirror of her dad's Chevy. After that it turned me off just to look at her, and probably her, me, too. Dr. Hoffman wanted to know if I'd been chewing nails or what. The other thing I hate is my asthma, which Bran says is all in my head. Mom says no, it's in my lungs, my brain is in my head. Then Bran generally says something like, that's not where Mikey's brains are, his brains are where he sits. Then Mom tells him to button it up and stop being so crude. But he's not, really, he's just being Bran. He's actually a pretty cool dude. Only just about half as cool as he thinks he is. He was 16 when this mess all happened, starting his junior year at Astoria High, already varsity in wrestling but just JV in football. Anyway, he's not anything like me, he's blonde and blue-eyed and he pumps iron, and he's not just a jock, either. He knows a lot of stuff. Mom and Dad are just regular. I mean, they're okay, but they don't know what's going on. Dad works at the museum, and Mom's a mom. We live in a big old three-story white frame house in the part of town called the Goondocks. It's not too far from the docks themselves, Astoria is right along the coast, way up Oregon, and it's mostly what Dad calls a blue-collar neighborhood. Mechanics, fishermen, construction workers when there's construction work around, that's who lives here. People like us. If there were any tracks in town, we'd probably be on the wrong side, at least according to the people who belong to the Hillside Country Club. They're the ones who call this the Goondocks and us the Goons. That's okay with us, though, 'cause we like who we are. That's why we call our gang the Goonies. It's not a gang, really. More like a club. Dad calls it an assortment, but then I told you, he works for the museum. First, there's Mouth Devereux. He's the oldest, and he's definitely the clown of the group. He's always cracking jokes or pulling pranks or just generally mouthing off. I've like never seen him without a smirk. He used to get D's in conduct all the time. Just trying to get attention is what the school counselor said. Just trying to get the last laugh is what I say. He can get laughs in different languages, actually. He's like a language expert or something. A man of many mouths. He can tell dirty jokes in French, Spanish, German, and Portuguese, and I don't even know where Portugal is. He's also like a rhyming fool. Like he can't help himself, sometimes, he just automatically talks and rhymes. And not only that, you can give him any topic, like cows, for instance, and in about 5 seconds he can come up with a little rhyming song about it. Like the old brown cow, sure knows how to pull that plow without saying ow. Only mouth can do it a lot better than me. And a lot funnier. If there's a joke floating around or a wisecrack begging to be made, mouth is always the one who can't resist. Anyway, his dad's a plumber, and that might have a lot to do with it, since it seems like that's a business where it's better to have a good sense of humor. Then, there's Chunk Cohen. You can imagine why he's called Chunk. But the other thing about him is that he's maybe the biggest storyteller in this hemisphere. I mean, we're talking major league fabrications. Don't get me wrong, he's a really great guy, it's just that there's times he can be truly bogus. I don't think he lies, exactly, because he thinks he's telling the truth. But somehow the story changes over in his mind from something that he wished happened, to something that might have happened, to something that sort of happened, to something that actually happened. And then once he tells the story, it's like he heard it somewhere, so it really must have happened. Then, once he's convinced himself it happened, he takes liberties polishing the story. The other thing about Chunk is that his parents were rejected from joining the Hillside Country Club, Chunk says, because they're Jewish, and the place is what he calls restricted, but I think it's just because they're assholes, the country club, I mean, not his parents. His parents are real nice, even though they dress just as bad as Chunk does. But I wouldn't join that country club if you paid me, and I'm glad Chunk's folks didn't get to drag him over to where he'd have to learn how to play golf instead of how to jump the barrels in Donkey Kong. The last Goonies, my next-door neighbor, Ricky Wong. We call him Data. The guy's a genius. He knows all there is about computers and electronics and stuff like that, and he's always making things. Two, cool stuff like rings that have flashlights in them and belt buckles that shoot smoke bombs. Really cool stuff. Except a lot of it doesn't always work exactly right. He loves James Bond movies, and that's where he dreams up some of his gadgets, but I think sometimes he must have gone for popcorn and missed something important. So that's the bunch of us. Not too rowdy, but then nothing much ever happened around here. Until last spring when we found out the country club owned most of the land and all of the houses in our section of the Goon Docks, and they were going to foreclose and tear it all down and build a lousy golf course right on the spot where we lived. Well, there were public hearings and investigations and impact studies all through the spring and summer, and at one point it looked like some big corporation in Portland actually owned half of it, but then it turned out that was just a holding company, whatever that is, for the country club dudas. So then it looked like all was lost, especially because those hillside snobs were known to have a lot of pull in Eugene, but then there was a last-minute court appeal, and the judge said we Goonies had the right of first refusal, so we could buy out all our own mortgages if we wanted to and if we had the money, so then we knew all was lost, because if any of us had any money, we wouldn't have been living down in the Goon Docks to begin with. So by Labor Day we knew for sure that we were going to be thrown out and would all have to scatter to the winds like dandelions and never see each other again. Well, the eviction notice came. October 25th, we had to be out. I thought of running away, but it didn't seem right to dump that on my parents too. Mouth was sort of inclined to trash the country club, and I admitted the idea had a ring to it. But somehow, the weeks passed, and we didn't get around to much of anything. And then suddenly October 24th was here, and I mean to tell you, I was really down. And I mean the pits. But then that weird October wind blew in through the attic window, and I suddenly knew something was going to happen. And it did. So this is the story of what happened that one long day last fall, the day before our eviction. And I know a lot of it's gonna sound hard to swallow, but swear to God, every word is true. It started with me and Brand sitting in the living room, staring out the window. Actually, I was sitting. Brand was hanging from his ankles by the chinning bar. Brand could always find something to do, but I was so bored, I was ticked off. "Nothing exciting ever happens around here," I said. Brand didn't answer, he was having too good a time swinging by his heels. But I was serious. This place was dead. Maybe it wasn't such a bad idea after all to leave. I mean, all these other kids had adventures, like Tom Sawyer and Luke Skywalker and Jim Hawkins. And what did I have? Orthodontist appointments. Who needs the Goon Docks? Who needs this house? I can't wait to get out of here, I griped, and this time it got Brand's attention. Really? He just kept on hanging there, but he knew what was what. He could see through me like lemon jello, and just the way he said really made me see through myself the same way. No way, I told him. I was just trying to make myself feel better. Trying to dilute myself. Delude yourself, he said. I told you he knew stuff. Yeah, I said. Well, I know how you feel, wimp. I sure am gonna miss this place, he admitted. No doubt about it, so was I. I gave myself a puff on the promotine mist inhaler for my asthma. My chest was feeling a little tight, and started to wander around the house. Kitchen. Nothing going on. Dining room. Definitely nothing. Rec room. I turned on the TV, but it was Saturday morning, which means kitty cartoons, which means nothing. There was a Mad magazine on the couch, so I sat down and picked it up. On the back was this thing called a fold-in, which is like a fold-out in a skin mag, only the opposite. What it is this picture with words, which says something like nuke the Reds, but then you fold the page in on itself and it suddenly makes this different picture totally, and says ban the bomb, or something. It's like a secret message sort of buried in the original. You probably don't know exactly what I'm talking about if you've never seen it, but you probably get the idea. Anyway, if you know what the deal is, you can look at the back cover and sometimes figure out what the secret picture and message is gonna be when the page is folded in. So I figured this one out. Boring. There was a half-finished jigsaw puzzle on the table, which I'm definitely good at. I can sort of see where pieces go, without really trying to figure it out. Like some people put all the blue pieces in one pile, and all the flowers in one pile, and do it scientifically like that. Not me. I just look it over, and it's like I can almost feel where a piece fits. It's instinctive. My guidance counselor in the 8th grade told me I score high in analysis of visual relationships but read below my level. It's not that I don't like to read. I do. It's just that as soon as I start reading, I see it all in my mind's eye and it's like a movie in my head, and I get sorta lost in those visual relationships. And my mind wanders a little and then I lose my place. Anyway, I picked up a piece of jigsaw puzzle and sort of squinted my eyes and turned it around and fit it snug into the piece it belonged next to. All instinct. And if there's one thing I learned from Obi-Wan Kenobi, it's to trust your instincts. Then Mouth came over. It didn't take a genius to see that me and Brand were depressed, and Mouth was no genius, so he dove right in trying to cheer us up. Wait. What's this, Finkelstein's funeral parlor? Look at you guys lying around like it was nuclear Saturday. Come on, dudes. This is our last weekend together. The last Goonie weekend. We should be going out in style, cruising the coast, sniffing some lace, downing the Bruce. Without his mouth missing a step, he slapped Brand in the belly and shifted into his Saturday Night Live John Belushi imitation, but no. You had to screw it up. You had to go and flunk your driving test. Brand reached out to swat him royally, but Mouth jumped back. His feet were even faster than his mouth. Still, Brand would have caught him if the bell hadn't rung at the front gate and stopped things short. Jerk alert, shouted Mouth. We all looked out the window and saw Chunk standing at the front gate, wearing his absolutely dumbest Hawaiian shirt, plaid pants, and black socks. If Chunk hadn't been a Goonie, he'd have been in serious trouble with clothes like that. He was shouting now. Hey, guys, you gotta let me in. I just saw the most amazing thing. Mouth called back, first you gotta do the truffle shuffle. Chunk's face fell, but he sighed and lifted his shirt to show his pudge, and then he did the twist, so it all jiggled around. This cracked Mouth up like it always did, but it just depressed me even more. I mean, Chunk was a stand-up kind of guy, and it wasn't like Mouth didn't have stuff we could laugh at. Or me, for that matter. Cut it out, Mouth, I said, and walked to the window. We have this rigged-up way of opening the gate from the window, so I dropped this rod from the sill onto the porch onto a bowling ball that rolled down a track and fell into a bucket that pulled down on a string that closed a bellows that blew up a balloon into a pin that popped it, and the noise scared our pet rabbit, Felix, who started running on the treadmill in his cage, and the revolving treadmill opened the valve that turned on the hose to the sprinkler in the front yard, and the blades of the rotating sprinkler were tied to another string, which was fastened to the gate and pulled the gate open when the sprinkler turned. Goonies are into stuff like that. I think it's because we can't control anything else about our lives, or the world, like nuclear war or famine or toxic dumps or where we might be living next week or what's for supper, but we can control every last detail about some contraption we build or joke we tell or between meal snack we snatch. Anyway, I opened the gate the way that I wanted to, and Chunk came in. I hadn't seen him, so excited, since the Burger King sweepstakes. "You guys should have seen it," he said. He could hardly wait to get inside. Cop cars chasing this four-wheel deal. It was the most amazing thing I ever saw. "More amazing than the time Michael Jackson came over to your house to use the bathroom?" I said. Mouth said, "More amazing than the time you ate your weight in straw hat pizza? More amazing than the time you saved those old people from that nursing home fire, Chipped and Brand?" Like I said, Chunk tended to lie like a rug, so none of us believed him. "Honest, you guys, this time it's for real. I was in Maloney's playing Star Wars and... did you blast all the towers?" "No, I was just starting when this car drives by, riddled with bullet holes." "Riddled? Where'd you hear that word, Dick Tracy?" "No, man, it's the truth, and the cops were chasing it, and they were all shooting." "So you turned your Star Wars guns toward the bad guys and vaporized them?" "No, really." "Chunk, did you happen to be drinking Maloney's new double chocolate shake at the time?" "Yeah, so what?" Mouth nodded. "It's the sugar rush. Makes some people wacky. I remember once." Before Mouth could mouth off anymore, or any of us could put down Chunk's tall one again, we suddenly heard the James Bond theme song blaring from just outside. Well, I knew what that meant. I stood up and pulled the big side window open wide. It was Data, flying in the window. Well, not flying, exactly. See, we had this 200-pound test nylon clothesline strung between his second-story bedroom and our first-floor den, so whenever he wanted to do it right, he'd signal with some James Bond music on his cassette, then I'd open the window, then he'd hang onto this pulley contraption and ride it down the rope right into our house. So that's what he did this time, only he was closer than I expected and I didn't get out of the way in time, and he shot right into me. We both tumbled, and I rolled into Brand, who clunked into Chunk. Chunk was not the swiftest guy ever assembled, so he fell flat-footed backward into this statue on the coffee table, knocking it solid to the floor, statue of this naked guy named David Dunn by this big-shot artist Michelangelo, who painted the Sistine Chapel for the Pope and then did part of Caesar's Palace in Las Vegas, I think. Anyway, Mom loved the statue. Chunk got kind of nervous and picked himself up and picked the statue up and started to put it back when we both noticed something at the same time, the statue's you know what, was broken off. I mean, I don't want to sound gross, but like I said, it was a statue of a naked guy, so I think you know what I'm talking about. So this was really bad news, and Mom was gonna have a cow when she found out. It made me a little wheezy just to think about, so I took a hit on the promotine inhaler. Chunk put the statue back in place, then I found the you-know-what under the table and held it up to the statue. "This is my mom's favorite piece," I said. "You wouldn't be here if it wasn't," cracked Mouth. Always wising off. Data pulled a map of the U.S. out of the backpack he always wore and opened it up on the floor. "Any you guys ever heard of Detroit?" he asked. He still had a little Chinese accent, his parents hardly spoke American at all. They ran a restaurant over on Algonquin Avenue that Mom said was good because it didn't use much MSG. "Detroit, great place," Mouth said. "It's where Motown started. Also got the highest murder rate in the country. They sing the blues, Cement Shoes, Bad News." Data looked kind of lost. "My father has brothers there with a big fancy restaurant they want him to help run. That's where we're moving when we lose our house tomorrow." "You shut up about that stuff," I told him. I'd put that all out of my mind for a while, and I didn't want to think about it now. "It'll never happen. Dad'll fix it," Not unless he gets his next 400 paychecks by tomorrow afternoon, said Brand. He wasn't one for living in any fairyland, which is what he said I did sometimes. But I figure, sometimes there's no reason not to, reality is so messed up. Once I saw some graffiti in a stall in the boys' locker room, John, that said, there is no gravity, the earth just sucks. Well, there's times when that's about right. And like he was trying to prove it just then, Brand walked over to the front window and motioned us. Come here. Check this out. We joined him and looked. Three guys in leisure suits were standing out front, looking our house up and down. Our house. One of them was talking, sweeping his arm out across the lay of the land like he was an explorer or some damn thing, claiming it all for his country. I expected him to plant a flag any second. The guy next to him had one of those surveyor's deals like a telescope on a compass and three legs, and he was aiming down our driveway. Then he pointed and said something, and the three of them laughed. Then the third guy picked a straight branch off the ground and imitated a golf swing with it, and then they all laughed again. It made me sick. Look at them. Smiling, said Brand. Practically drooling, said Mouth. They just can't wait until tomorrow when they foreclose on all the foreclosures, said Data. And trash the goon docks, Mouth added. Money talks, Goonie walks. Brand said, when they wreck our house, I hope they make it the sand trap. And they never get their balls out. I sort of laughed a thin kind of laugh. This is war, said Data. He looked real angry. I knew it was coming. Go on, Mikey, open that window, I'll get them. I got my special agent assault options all rigged. He opened his jacket and removed the cassette player that was hanging around his neck. Tied across his chest was this homemade box thing with cords sticking out of it, and small plastic rings at the end of each cord, like the thing you pull at the back of a chatty Kathy when you want to make her talk. So then he whips a pair of aviator shades out of his backpack and puts them on and plugs them into the box on his chest with a sort of adapter plug and shouts, glasses of death, out the window and pulls the yellow ring on the box. We all stood back, cause you could never tell what was going to happen when Data jerked his chain. What happened this time was two little suction darts shot out of the sides of his sunglasses and stuck to the window, pulling the glasses off with them. I wasn't sure if that was what was supposed to happen or not, but Data didn't seem too pleased with the results. He screamed even louder, stepping back, pinchers of peril. We stepped back even farther. He pulled another cord. A set of mechanical chatterbox teeth shot out of his chest on the end of a thick metal coil, sort of like a slinky, only more. The teeth chattered away across the room, on a super spring, so they sounded like a machine gun until they bit onto our front curtains and just hung there, clamped down like a junkyard dog on a dead rat. Data tried to pull it free, but it wasn't letting go. He pulled a couple more cords, but nothing happened. He was starting to get real worked up, but Mouth put his arm around Data's shoulder and said, cool it, 00-7. He said it nice, though. It didn't matter that Data's contraptions didn't work much, it was the thought that counted. And we all appreciated his efforts. Just like he appreciated Mouth's thought now, even though Mouth's mouth didn't know exactly what to say. Just then my mom came in. She was pretty old, 40 or so, but still better looking than most moms. She used to model parkas for the Sears catalog. Anyway, her arm was broken now and in a sling, from her accident with the spin dryer. I remember I broke my arm once when I fell into the excavation at that new housing development, Cuesta Verde Estates, and the doctor had to break it back in the other direction to set it. He said that was the only way to make it straight. I thought of that when Mom came in the room, so it was on my mind later, when we got to the lighthouse, but I'll tell about that later. Anyway, Mom came in now with this made from Mexico or El Salvador or one of those places Mom won't go because of the water or the rebels. Boys, she said, this is Rosalita. The boys waved. Chunk stood in front of the broken statue of David so Mom wouldn't notice. Rosalita doesn't speak much English, Mom said, and she's got to help me with the packing. So I was wondering if one of you, well, I know some of you have taken Spanish in school. I speak perfect Spanish, Mrs. Walsh, said Mouth. Like I said, He had a mouth in a bunch of languages. That's wonderful, Clark. Mom smiled at him. His paper name was Clark, so that's what most of the parents called him. I need help explaining some things to her, so if you'd just come with us for a few minutes. Yes, ma'am, said Mouth, and shot to her side. Data rolled his eyes at me. Bran went back to hanging upside down. Mom split with Mouth and Rosalita. Chunk looked at me with this sick face and picked up the statue. There was like a giant hole in the thing's crotch. So Chunk gives me this pukey grin and says, think your mom's gonna notice? I gave him a bottle of Elmer's glue and told him to do something right for a change. Then I went after Mouth to make sure he wasn't grossing out my mom. They were in my parents' bedroom at the dresser. I stood back, at the door. Mom was talking to Rosalita, loud and slow like that was going to make her understand. Socks and underwear in the top drawer. Shirts and blouses in the second. Pants in the bottom. Always separate the clothes. Then she turned to Mouth and said, can you translate that? Sure, Mrs. Walsh. He nodded. Then he turned to Rosalita and said a bunch of Spanish stuff that he told me later meant the marijuana goes in the top drawer. The cocaine and speed in the second. The heroin in the bottom. Always separate the drugs. Anyway, that's what he said, but I believe him because Rosalita looked kind of weirded out. Mom just smiled. Then they went out the other door, into the hallway, and Mom pointed to the trapdoor in the ceiling. That's the attic. Mr. Walsh doesn't like anybody up there. Never. Then she nodded to Mouth again. This time he told me his rap went, never go up there. It's filled with Mr. Walsh's sexual torture devices. And there was no doubt, this time Rosalita's face turned white under the brown, so she looked kind of beige. The mom opened the supply closet. This is the supply closet. You'll find everything you need inside. Brooms, mops, insecticide, Lysol. And this time after Mouth finished saying it in Spanish, Rosalita seemed ready to head back south of the border, rebels or no rebels. What he'd told her was, if you do a bad job, you'll be locked in here with the cockroaches for 2 weeks without food or water. Anyway, the way Rosalita was looking, I got the idea, even if Mom didn't, so I just left. I didn't much like it when Mouth jived like that, whether it was on Chunk's lard belly or some poor lady who couldn't speak English yet. But thinking of Chunk, I wondered how he was doing with the glue job, so I headed for the rec room where I heard the TV on. When I got there, Bran was watching the tube, and Data was watching Chunk finish repairing the thing. Its back was to me, so I walked around to face it just as Chunk took his hand away. How's that? He said. The dork had glued the thing upside down. So it was pointing up. We all rolled over laughing, even Brand, who took a second first to slap Chunk in the head. It was just a crack up to look at. I knew trouble was on her way down the hall, though. Brand made a dirty joke, but I guess I won't tell it right now. We heard everyone coming downstairs from upstairs. Data snapped his fingers and pulled a leaf off the potted philodendron and taped it to the David's crotch, and we all got down to play marbles in front of an old Abbott and Costello movie just as Mom came in with Mouth and Rosalita. Rosalita looked positively nauseous. Mouth didn't tell me right then what he'd laid on the sorry woman, but I could see it wasn't any winning lottery ticket. Mom just kissed him on the cheek. Thank you, Clark, that was so nice of you. Nice is my middle name, Mrs. Walsh. Made me want to barf. Then Mom spotted the statue. She had a sixth sense for stuff like that. Lawrence, she said with a tone in her voice. Lawrence was Chunk's other name. Mom also had a seventh sense for knowing who did stuff like that. She pointed to the statue and held out her hand. Chunk handed it to her. She took off the fig leaf and looked. And wouldn't you know it, the glue began to stretch, and that old you-know-what started tilting down right at Mom, while she was looking at it. I took a slug of promotine. Rosalita made the sign of the cross. I think we were the only two in that whole room that had any sense. Mom was about to say something, then decided it just wasn't worth it. So she said something else. I'm taking Rosalita to the grocery store. We'll be home in about an hour. Brandon, you stay inside with Mikey. It looks like rain, and I don't want him out in that with his asthma. I pocketed my inhaler. He should be in a plastic bubble, said Brand. My asthma gave him a pain. I'm serious, Brandon, said Mom. He takes one step outside, and you're, she thought for a second, trying to come up with something hip enough to make Brand do what she told him. Or you're dead meat. She gave this real cash smile. Way to go, Mom, you're too cool for school. Brand rolled his eyes, and Mom and Rosalita split. The second they were out the door, Brand jumped me. You want a breathing problem, he said. You got one. He put me in a headlock I couldn't come close to breaking, but I got a couple good jabs in. He finally let me go when I started to wheeze. Mouth had this thoughtful expression on his face, which was always a dangerous sign. Hey, what's your father gonna do with all that stuff in the attic, he asked. It was museum stuff. When the Astoria Historical Museum moved to the Endicott building 3 years ago, they had a big fundraising show of all their oldest stuff, and my dad was in charge of moving it, and some of the stuff that didn't fit in the show got stored here temporarily until the move was complete, only it turned out to be temporary storage that the honchos at the museum sort of forgot to stash elsewhere. He's gonna give it back to the museum, I said. Or to whoever they pick to be the new assistant curator. Curator. Brand corrected me again. Sometimes he was really a pain, asthma or no asthma. Mouth's eyes got big as his mouth. That means it's all gonna go to the rich people, anyway. Let's go up and see if there's anything we can take for our parents.
Yeah.
Cool. Let's do it. They all jumped up and ran off to the attic like this was the best idea they'd ever heard. All except me. Hey, guys. My dad's responsible for all that stuff. Don't wreck anything. Brand? You know, I'll bet the museum's got a list of it all somewhere. Guys? But they were history. So I just put my marble bag in my pocket and followed. Actually, history's what it's all about, and we were about to discover some, and then make some. By the time I got upstairs, they had the stepladder out and the trapdoor open. Brand was first up, with a flashlight, and the others were right behind. As usual, I was last. When we got up there, we just stopped and stared in amazement. I'd never been in the attic before, Dad never let us, and I was as blown away as anyone. First of all, it was pretty dark. There was a skylight in the ceiling, but the storm clouds Mom had seen were really thick now, kind of black and purple. Even so, with Brand's flashlight we could see plain enough. It was a huge old dusty room, jam-packed with the far-outest stuff you could imagine. Historical stuff, some of it must have been like centuries old. Oil paintings, sculptures, broken antique furniture, costumes, whaling harpoons, pirate stuff, Indian stuff. Great stuff. I can't believe something this cool is in your house, Mouth whispered. This is the best junk I've ever seen, said Chunk. Suddenly this wild rip of lightning tore over the skylight, with a thunder crack in its shadow, and in a second rain was spattering the glass and throwing funny patterns on all of us. And I don't mind saying, I was just the slightest bit touchy. Okay. You guys saw it, I said. Now let's get out of here. What's the matter, scared again, said Brand. Yeah, just like you in the elevator. I answered. I knew that would get him. He hated to be reminded of this one time we were on an elevator that got stuck between floors and he like totally freaked out, and I just got on the elevator phone and sort of ran the show. I mean, I think we've all got something like that to deal with, but Brand sees it otherwise. He decided someone must have put some angel dust into the ventilation system, and that's why he blew his wad, and I was just immune to the stuff or something. Anyway, he made me promise not to tell. So when I mentioned the elevator this time, he got me in another headlock and whispered, "You shut up about that elevator. You understand?" Huh? I nodded as well as I could with my head being crushed, so then he pushed me to the floor. I coughed and couldn't stop until I snorted a little promotine. Can we go now? It's pretty dusty up here. I think my hay fever's acting up. Brand just ignored me, though. Come on, let's look around, he said. He started walking through the collection. We all followed, sort of tiptoe, so as not to disturb anything. And it was something. A wooden peg leg, a half set of ivory false teeth, a walrus mask all mouse-chewed, a hand-carved oar with the handle broken off, some torn lace gloves, a rusted compass without the needle, some drawing on a piece of whalebone, Brand called it scrimshaw, a piece of real skull. It was totally cool and kind of spooky. Suddenly I heard this high-pitched voice calling to me from out of the darkness. Mikey, oh, Mikey, come to me, come and kiss me. Brand turned his light on it. There in the corner was a full-size oil painting, torn in places, of a pirate captain and a naked woman, and there was a tongue jutting out of a tear in the woman's mouth, licking her lips. It was pretty creepy at first, until I realized it was a tongue that could only have come from mouth's mouth. He was behind the painting. Come here, Mikey, he said in a kind of ghost voice. Make me feel like a woman. I'll make you feel like a punching bag, said Brand. Stop being so perverted, Mouth, I said. You're wrecking the painting. Mouth came out from behind the painting. Easy, dude. It was already trashed. Like everything else here, trashed, bashed, slashed, or gashed. We went back to exploring. What is all this stuff? Said Chunk. The museum did some kind of show, I said, explaining it to him. With historical things they found all around here. And these are the rejects. Chunk nodded. Kinda like us. It was true, though. I felt very in touch with these discards. We started rummaging through the piles. I found an eye patch and put it on. Mouth and Data each scored a feathered hat. Brand picked up an old cutlass. I felt like I'd somehow seen it all before. I mean, I know I'd seen stuff like it on lots of pirate movies. But it wasn't that. It was more like this stuff had some kind of special meaning for me. Almost like maybe I wore these clothes once before, in a previous life or something. I mean, I don't really believe in reincarnation, but that's what it felt like. Or maybe it was just a feeling of time goes on. You know, like some guys wore this stuff, and then they took it off and it knocked around for a while, and then we wore it and knocked around for a while, and then someone else will find it. Us, them, now, whenever. All part of the same thing. You know what I'm talking about? I can't explain it too good. My counselor in the 8th grade told me I didn't do well in verbal skills, either. But I guess you already scoped that out. Anyway, Data started getting into the same thing, the sort of sameness of us and those old-time guys who originally had this stuff. Like there was some kind of connection. Just think of it, Data said, all this stuff belonged to guys who walked on the same ground that we do. They went swimming in the same ocean, they breathed the same air. Yeah, they had to breathe the herring factory air too. That was Chunk's contribution to all this deep talk. No, they didn't have herring then, Data explained patiently. Being of Chinese descent, he had a lot of patience. Also had a major thing with history, like I said before, he was a kind of all-around heavy thinker. This was right after Christopher Columbus, he went on saying, in the 17th century. They only had ships. They were adventure guys and explorers. They made maps and captured Indians and spent all their time killing each other with swords, you know, Errol Flynn stuff. That was right, too. My dad used to tell me about some of it. This place was like a suburb of the Spanish Main at one time. And up here, in this old attic collection, I could almost see it, almost smell it. You know what I'm talking about? I walked over to a corner near the skylight where a bunch of old framed photographs and drawings were stacked. I started flipping through them. Right above me, a little piece of glass had cracked out of the skylight. It wasn't raining now, but the wind had picked up and was blowing in onto my face. That old October wind. And suddenly something about the way I was standing and the funny greenish-purple sky and all this old and stuff around me and that zoned out something's gonna happen wind and that musty attic smell. I just knew I was onto something. And it was right then that I looked down and noticed this framed map. I picked it up to look at closer, but it was impossible to read, all covered over by this dusty, yellowed glass. I tried to pull off the frame, but it wouldn't budge. I turned it over, but the back was covered by a sheet of wood. The only way I was ever going to get to read that map was to break the glass. But I couldn't bring myself to do it. I mean, my dad was responsible for all this stuff, I couldn't just go around trashing it. On the other hand, Uncle Art always said you can't make an omelet unless you break a few eggs. On the other hand, Uncle Art is still on probation, I think, or maybe he's in that work program now. Anyway, just then I noticed Chunk working on trying to get a paint can that he'd accidentally stepped into off his foot. I thought I should help him, but I couldn't if I was holding the map, so I got an idea. "Hey, Chunk, hold this for me," I said, and handed it to him. He nodded and took it. I had to stand there maybe 10 or 15 seconds, trying to figure out the best way to help him before he suddenly lost his balance and fell over, dropping the map, shattering the glass into a zillion pieces. Like I said before, Chunk wasn't the lightest guy on his feet. "Can't you do anything right?" I sort of snapped at him. He shrugged, kind of embarrassed, and I was sorry right away that I'd made him feel bad, just for breaking my eggs, I mean, glass. So I helped him up and got the paint can off his foot and then, with this weird feeling, I picked up the map. It slid out of the frame real easy now, along with a small gold doubloon. Swear to God, a real gold coin. The map was all creased and cracked and hand-painted in perfect detail. All of the writing was in Spanish with little arrows by some of it and little pictures by some of it, and at the bottom it was signed by some guy named One-Eyed Willie. It was written in Spanish, but that's what Mouth said it said. I stared at that signature. Man, I stared. Something about it, I don't know, something just got me. I looked over at the part of the map that was coastline. It looked real familiar to me. I followed it up slowly with my eyes, around this peninsula that looked kinda like the head of a hammerhead shark, then back up along this pretty straight area that got more and more full of coves, until it came to this kind of mountainous cliff drawn in, and right below the cliff was this big red X. I felt, like thunderstruck. I just knew, somehow. You know, like X marks the spot. And all this stuff I've been telling you, about fooling the maid and fooling my mom and all this other fooling around, that was all kid stuff. And this X marked the end of all that. Chapter 2. All the other guys gathered around. They were still wearing some of the pirate things, hats and scarves and stuff like that. The doubloon was like a large round coin, with sort of a coat of arms stamped on it, and three irregular triangular holes cut into it, two near one edge, one near the opposite. There was also a cross stamped near the third hole, and Spanish words around the edge, and some notches on one side. I held it up to the light. Chunk took it out of my hand and looked at it real close. "This says 1532. Is that a year, or what?" "It's your top score on Donkey Kong," said Mouth. Data ran his finger along the map's coastline, like he was into some really deep stuff. "Maybe that's how it used to look," he said. "You know, before they put up all the Wendy's and McDonald's." "All the good stuff," Chunk added. Someday he was gonna do the editorial rebuttal at the end of the 6 o'clock news, I bet. Brand pointed to the Spanish words at the top of the map. "What's all this say?" Mouth translated. "It says Chunk's father, screws, sheep." Chunk hit him a good one, right in the kidneys. Mouth just gave his usual obnoxious cackle, though. Then he got on his straight face and translated again, for real, this time. "Ye intruders, beware. Crushing death and grief. Soaked with blood. Of the trespassing, thief." We all looked at him like he was jacking around again, rhyming just to hear himself rhyme, but he raised his hand in the Boy Scout pledge, which meant no lie. Data got kind of BFD about the whole thing then. "That map's old news," he said. "Everybody and his grandfather went after that treasure when our parents were our ages. Didn't you ever hear of that pirate guy? One-Eyed Willie?" And Mouth sure wasn't gonna believe in anything Data didn't believe in. "Sounds like your basic, boring Saturday morning TV junk for teeny kids," he said, "just too cool." "Hey! One-Eyed Willie," I said. I was trying to get some enthusiasm going. He was the biggest pirate of his time. My dad told me all about him one night. Yeah, Dad'll tell you anything to get you to go to sleep, said Brand. There was no point in dealing with Brand when he got like this, though. He had millions in treasure, I told them, but the king sent ships after him. So Willie took his ship, called the Inferno, and ducked into this cave to hide. But the king's men sealed him up inside it with cannon fire. It was clear as a picture to me. Your dad ought to write for the movies, said Mouth. My dad doesn't lie, I said, and he told me that Willie and his bunch spent years hiding out down there, building these underground caves loaded with all kinds of booby traps to protect the treasure. Right. Sure. Whatever you say, man. Then Chunk looked down to the place where I'd found the map, and next to it he found a framed yellow newspaper with a photo of an old, smiling man who looked sort of like Gabby Hayes in a miner's hat. Chunk read the headlines on top of the photograph. Chester Copperpot, missing in pursuit of local legend. And then under that, in smaller type, he read, reclusive scavenger claims I have the key to One-Eyed Willie. Data doubted. Nobody ever found nothing. Why do you think that map is sitting up here instead of in a safe deposit box somewhere? Their doubts were like water down my back, though. But what if, you guys? What if this leads to One-Eyed Willie's stash? Then Brand stepped in, like a cold, rational fish. Like a wet blanket. Like an adult. Take off all that junk, you guys. My mom's gonna come back soon. And then the doorbell rang. It was like time for study hall or something, with the hall monitors out in force. We all tore off our pirate clothes and raced down to see who was at the door and to show whoever it was that we were being nice, behaved kids. It was the three guys in leisure suits. They were standing behind the front screen door like big flies. The ugliest one kept practicing his golf swing. The closest one talked. Hello, guys. I'm Mr. Perkins. Troy's father. Perkins was one of the owners of the country club, and a bigger jerk has never existed in this galaxy, except maybe for his idiot son Troy. Brand kept his cool, though. My dad's not here, Mr. Perkins. Well, then, is your mommy home? What a flake. No, sir, said Brand, she's out at the market buying Pampers for all us kids. Perkins laughed like someone had taught him how, then stopped like he forgot the way the rest of it went. Well, you can give these papers to your father to read over, and sign. Somebody from my office will pick them up in the morning. Brand took the papers and closed the door in the guy's ugly face. What is all that stuff? I asked. But I knew. It's Dad's business, said Brand. He was real depressed now. We sort of looked at all the legal forms, but they were too complicated to figure out. Then we looked out the window at the three insect men as they walked away, and they seemed real simple to figure out. Scums with money. I remember seeing this old movie on the tube, You Can't Take It With You, about this stuffy, tight banker who's about to foreclose on the good-hearted heroes, but they convince him with love and generosity in the end that it's better to be kind and fun than rich, so he doesn't foreclose on them. He plays the harmonica instead. Stuff like that only happens in the movies, though. If I found any treasure with that map, I said, I'd pay all Dad's bills and buy his mortgage, and then maybe he could get to sleep at night instead of sitting up trying to figure out a way for us to stay here. Yeah. Me too. Me three. Brand just grabbed me by the hair, though. You can forget about any adventures, limp lungs. You go outside now and Mom will ground my ass. And I got a date with Andy on Friday. You're dreaming, dude, said Mouth. Besides, who's gonna drive you? Her parents? Then you gotta make it with her and her mother. Eat it, Mouth, Brand said, and walked back to his exercise area. I pulled the map from inside my shirt, and the guys pushed in to check it out. Another lightning bolt flashed outside. It looked like blue neon. The map brightened and dimmed. It looked like my future. So me and the guys powwowed and came up with an exceptional plan. We waited until Brand was sitting in his straight-back chair in the rec room, pulling his spring coil chest exerciser across his chest. We drifted around behind him, and then, the second he finished the 15th rep of his third set and dropped his arms like a couple quivering lumps at his sides, we jumped into action. Mouth held Brand's arms to his sides, me and Chunk grabbed the exerciser and wrapped it around his chest, arms, and the back of the chair, and Data clamped the two ends of the exerciser together and back. Brand was totally chained. It was totally cool. Hey! Wait, let me out! We were out of there, though. We snuck through the backyard. Grandpa was sleeping in the hammock, probably dreaming about Ziegfeld's Follies or something. Careful, don't wake Grandpa. I whispered. Hush, yeah, don't wake him. Yeah, hush. Just as we rounded the corner of the house, though, Mouth shoved the hammock, and Grandpa woke up. It's not that Mouth was a mean person, you gotta understand, he just had this basic urge to do whatever it was he shouldn't do. I think it was genetic or something. Anyway, we split before Grandpa saw us, slipped out the back, Jack, and ran to the side of the house. Mouth let the air out of Brand's 10-speed while we climbed onto our dirt bikes. I looked to make sure Mouth wasn't slashing the tires or anything. It took him 376 lawn jobs to pay for that, I said. It's his most favorite thing in the world. Now it's his most flattest thing in the world. Suddenly we heard Brand screaming from inside the house. Mikey, I'm gonna hit you so hard, when you wake up, your clothes are gonna be out of style. I didn't need any more encouragement. We shot down the driveway and were gone. We rode toward the old coast road, which seemed like the best place to begin, according to the map. To get there we had to pass the edge of the business district, which meant two things. First, we went by the museum. Dad was up on the rooftop, nailing down a leaky shingle. Hi, Dad. I called out to him. He waved back and smiled. I sort of wanted to say goodbye to him, in case this hunt took me somewhere I couldn't get back from. I just had that feeling. You know? The last place we passed on the way out of town was the Stop and Snack. I zoomed on by it, the map spread open on my handlebars, headed for the coast and maybe Dire Straits. When I looked over my shoulder, though, I saw three bikes parked in front of the Stop and Snack, and the guys walking inside. I skid-stopped on the gravel. I held up the map. Hey, guys, what about this? Huh? They just waved me over and kept on in. I guess old habits die hard. So I turned around and joined them. Last one in, as usual. Data was buying a pack of baseball cards, and Mrs. Keister, the old lady who ran the place, was ringing it up on a computer cash register. The thing was jammed or something, though, so she started pounding it with her hand. Data made her stop. He opened the little door at the back of the thing and began fiddling with the wires. Mouth was standing at the magazine rack, looking kind of sly. While Mrs. Keister was busy with Data, Mouth slipped a copy of Playboy inside a copy of Omni, and casually started reading, mostly around the middle of the magazine. Chunk was over by the junk food, and just like Mouth, he was looking pretty cagey. Suddenly he tore open a Twinkie, slurped out the cream filling, then rewrapped the Twinkie and put it back on the shelf. It was really gross. I walked up to him and waved the map in his face. Hey, Chunk, come on, we were gonna look for rich stuff, we gotta do it now. Hey, don't get nervous. We gotta get provisions, don't we? We're going on an expedition, aren't we? He had a point, I guess, even if I was too excited to eat. I went over to Data as Chunk went to work on a ding-dong. Data was still messing with the cash register, and that got me a little down. Data, what if they make us move? I said. Where are we gonna go? I was starting to get depressed again, to have second thoughts about our adventure. I mean, if we could get sidetracked by a 2-byte computer, a skin mag, and a hostess ho-ho, we weren't gonna get very far on any treasure hunt. Data? I said again. Don't bother him while he's working, said Mrs. Keister. I walked over to Mouth, to try to charge him up again. Mouth, what if they start tearing down our houses? The centerfold was the only thing charging him up, though. Take it easy, dude, let your folks handle this. That's their job. Our job is to get through the weekend without destroying too many brain cells. I took a hit of promotine mist, I was feeling that low. I picked up a copy of Matt off the rack, flipped to the back, and checked out the fold-in. I guessed it, as usual. I happened to look down just then and noticed that all the way at the bottom of the stand was a section of dusty old tourist maps of Astoria. I pulled one out, sat down on the floor, and opened it. Then I took out the pirate map and opened it, and lay the two side by side. And they were the same. I mean, basically the same. The coastlines were identical, and a bunch of the cliffs were exact matches, even though some were different, probably because of earthquakes and tidal waves and stuff over the years. But the really important thing was that the place where the X was on the pirate map was at a place that looked exactly the same on the tourist map, and it was a place that I knew exactly where it was. "I know where this is," I whispered. This was too great to believe. We were in business again. I was totally stoked. I jumped up and ran over to Chunk to tell him the good news. He was bent way over into the ice cream freezer, though, licking the top layers of the Swensons and then replacing the lids. That was his favorite thing, so he wasn't about to be interrupted. So I ran to Data, who was still diddling the wires in the register. "Data," I said. Just then the machine beeped and lit up, and Mrs. Keister pinched Data's cheek with a big smile, the way she does. Suddenly Mouth's voice rang through the store. "Jerk alert." I looked over to the entrance, and Mouth wasn't kidding. Troy Perkins was coming in. Like I said before, Troy wins Dork of the Year, hands down. And don't think it's because he's rich, because I know a lot of guys from Hillside that play it just as straight as anybody. But like I also said before, Troy's got a big handicap to begin with, just because his father is Mr. Perkins, who could use a few lessons in earthling behavior. So, anyway, Troy strutted into the Stop and Snack like he owned the place, which he probably did. He was wearing his coolo tennis outfit, and his hair was styled, and so were his fingernails, what he called manicured. Get the picture? But the thing is, he was walking in with Andy Carmichael and Steph Steinbrenner. Now Andy is the girl Brand was hoping to take out Saturday night, and she was like so foxy, it was intense. She was wearing her cheerleader's outfit now, but she was also wearing Troy's letter sweater with his name sewn on the pocket. Dum-da-dum-dum. Steph was Andy's best friend. She wasn't nearly as pretty as Andy, but she was tough enough. She lived in the Goondocks, like us. Andy was from Hillside. Steph wore glasses. Andy wore contacts. Steph once punched out Lenny Dole. That was before high school, but the reputation stuck. She also had a rep about sex, like there was always some guy popping up saying he had a friend who did it with old Steph Steinbrenner. But you couldn't believe that kind of shit. Still, she did have a certain way she walked, and her brothers were always in trouble, and she hung out sometimes with Macy and those motorcycle guys, and she smoked and had a fake ID. Anyway, Steph and Andy were sort of opposites, but they whispered to each other all the time and went to the bathroom together, so I guess they had a lot in common too. Anyway, Troy walked straight over to the magazine rack, grabbed the Playboy out of Mouth's hand, and started paging through it. Mouth glared at Troy like maybe he could kill him with his eyes, but Troy didn't drop, he just kept looking at the pictures. So finally Mouth backed off, without mouthing off even once, like he couldn't be bothered to waste his breath on such a jerk. So instead he just picked up another magazine. Steph came up behind Mouth. "You still smell like a plumber's son," she said. "You still smell like a fisherman's daughter," he said back. Which is what they both were. I think they sort of liked each other, though. Andy walked over to them. Troy nudged her with this really big grin and held up the Playboy centerfold and said, "Can you measure up?" Andy looked away, kind of embarrassed, like, of course, she would be. So then, to make matters worse, Troy laughed, like you knew it wasn't a real laugh. He was just trying to make a point, but the point was his head. I don't know, it really made me feel bad. "You're a lot prettier than that, Andy," I said. She was too. She didn't have those huge Annie Fanny boobs, but so what? you know what I mean? Anyway, she smiled at me. Gave me this real flutter in the pit of my stomach, like when I had to recite the rhyme of the Ancient Mariner on stage at the Spring Assembly. Like I wasn't sure I'd said the right thing, but there was no taking it back. I don't know, I just haven't had much luck with women. I mean, I know I'm supposed to, but I don't know where to begin. Especially with anyone as pretty as Andy. Like, my braces alone are so ugly, it seems that most girls must be embarrassed just to look at me. Not to mention which it probably wouldn't be fair passing on my wimpy, sick genes to a kid, so I'm not gonna get married, so why bother dating and stuff in the first place, right? Troy walked over to the freezer where Chunk was still and over his head licking ice cream, and he brought the freezer door down on Chunk's back, trapping him there. Really rude. My mom's making a goon pizza tonight, Troy yucked. She's gonna need some frozen dough. Why don't you leave him alone? I shouted. The poor guy was flopping his legs all over like a fish. I mean, he was obviously freaking out. Troy let him alone then. But he came over to me. Did I hear you right? He said. Did I hear a goonie telling me what to do? I thought he was going to hit me. My chest got tight. I was about to crouch, but suddenly he grabbed my map off the floor. The old one. Hey, let go, I shouted. That's art you're messing with. I mean, if he wrecked it, my dad was gonna kill me, and I sure wasn't gonna tell him what it was really all about. So he didn't know how important it really was, but he could see it was important to me. So he held it over my head. He was pretty much taller than me, grabbed a pack of tobacco from the counter, poured it onto the paper, and started rolling it like a cigarette. Just can't get rolling papers like these anymore, he said. I grabbed for it, but he knocked me down. Big tough guy. Then he took a butane lighter out of his pocket and lit the end of the rolled map. I couldn't believe it. He took a puff. The end of the map started burning. I could hardly watch, and I had to put my hands over my eyes. The jerk was actually blowing smoke rings. Just then Mouth walked up and raised his eyebrows. You know, he said, real cool, the way you're puffing on that cigarette, it reminds me of something. Yeah? What's that? Said Troy. The time I French kissed your mother, said Mouth. Troy freaked. I mean, you'd have thought he actually had a thing for his mother, the way he looked. Whatever it was, though, he dropped the map and went for Mouth. I stomped out the fire and grabbed the map. Unfortunately for Mouth, this time his feet weren't as fast as his voice box. Troy tackled him and started punching. Mouth covered his face, but Troy was a lot bigger. I jumped onto Troy's back and got him in a headlock. But I was a lot smaller. Data ran up and shouted smoke screen and held out his arm. A garden hose was sticking out from his sleeve, but instead of shooting smoke at us, it just kind of smoldered and burned him, so he ran over to the ice machine and buried his arm in the cubes. Troy pulled me off with his left hand and cocked his right to smash my face in. Halfway to my nose, his fist was stopped short, though, and was held in midair by somebody else's. Brand. Nobody hits my brother except me, he said. Troy got off me and stood up. He was scared of Brand, no doubt about it. He had this kind of sick grin bullies get when they're not ganging up on someone. I'd love to have seen him sweat himself into a puddle. Can't wait until Monday, he said. I could hear in his voice that he was so scared, he was talking through his nose. Monday's when my dad kicks you all out in the street. He stood back and did a golf swing, like he was supposed to be a pro or something. While you goonies are piling all your stuff into moving vans, I'll be teeing off on what used to be your front lawns. Then he laughed and sounded like he was clearing snot, and he said to Andy, our court time starts in 5 minutes. I'll be waiting outside. Then he walked out, real casual, sat down in his red Mustang convertible, and turned on the radio so loud, we could hear it all the way in the store. Brand looked at Andy kind of angry, hurt and jealous, and she looked back at him with a look I'd like her to have looked at me, and then Brand kind of melted, and then Andy shrugged like this was a bad time, and then Brand slumped like he was trying to be nonchalant, and then Andy turned and left. I quickly unrolled the map. It was okay, Only the edges were burned. But Bran was really broiled. He grabbed the map and slapped my head. "You know how I got loose," he said. "Mom came home and unhooked me. She was totally pissed off, man, and so was I. And Rosalita was there with her brother, and she thought it was some kind of sexual torture device, thanks to Mouth. And then Mom told me that if I didn't find you and get you back in 30 minutes, we were both grounded. And then you know what happened? Somebody flattened my tires, so I had to steal Data's sister's bike to get over here, 'cause I knew you bozos wouldn't get any farther than this on your great adventure." Then he pinched my arm and shoved me ahead of him. "You just blew your whole life, pal." He stuffed the map into his back pocket and looked at the other guys. "The rest of you guys too, you're all history. We don't need friends like you." Mouth put his arm around Bran's shoulder and started singing, real sincere. "Here's to good friends, tonight is kinda special, the beer we pour must be something more, somehow." And all the time he was singing, he was pulling the map out of Bran's back pocket. Bran shoved him away. "You don't have to drink to make friends, wimp." That was when Mouth showed us the map, with his back to Bran. We all made a run for it. We were on our bikes before Bran realized what happened and were out of the parking lot before he got to the neighbor kid's bike, which was about 3 sizes too small for him, and no way he could catch us. So we were out of there. Mouth handed off the map to me at the next corner, but I didn't even have to look at it yet. I took us right to the coast highway and turned north. We were on our way. Springsteen was blasting from Data's tape deck, and somehow, with that cloudy wind and those darkish fir trees all up the coast, it was just perfect discovery weather. Something was definitely happening. One of the clouds on the horizon blew into a different shape so that it looked just like a pirate ship to me. I see pictures in clouds all the time. Mom says it's because I'm a dreamer, but they look so real, I don't see how other people don't see what I see. It's like jigsaw puzzles, I guess. Anyway, the fact that this cloud was a pirate ship seemed like a pure sign, no two ways about it, so I knew my instincts were right, and, if I just kept following my nose, I'd get a noseful of something soon enough. I checked the map after riding about 20 minutes and took the first turnoff beyond the old schoolhouse, leading up over Piedmont Ridge. In the distance we could see the edge of the hillside country club. Mouth spat. We went down the ridge and past the coast road to where we overlooked the ocean again, and the first thing I saw was these 3 rocks sticking up out of the water in a V. And I knew them from somewhere. I stopped pedaling, and the guys stopped with me. "I know this place," I whispered. "This is it." It was the beginning of the place on the old map that didn't show up on the tourist map. It was marked by those 3 rocks, and by this tall, natural pillar of rock that stuck straight up at the bottom of the hill that we were at the top of. It was a steep hill with lots of jutting, jagged slabs pointing out all over and hardly a bike path down through it, nothing we would have taken if it hadn't been on the secret map. But we took it now. We walked our bikes, it was so steep. At the bottom it turned into a sort of gravel path that veered off in a funny direction just past the tall stone pillar. We got on our bikes and rode real slow. The coast road was behind us now, and then I don't know where it was. We went through this place with mossy trees, and then there was this rickety old wooden bridge across a creek, so we walked our bikes over that, and then next thing, we were out of the woods and onto this rocky beach. We kept going. Trees came right up to the beach at one point, and we were through them, down a hollow and up a hill where the trees thinned out again and left us with a clear view of the ocean right below us. And here's what we saw. There was a small peninsula with waves smashing all around it. On the near side was a little cemetery with a bunch of crooked old falling down gravestones. Beyond that, at the tip of the land, was a tall stone lighthouse, broken off at the top and bent over so it almost looked like it was a giant tombstone too. And sitting between them was a square one-story building. Real run down. It was made of wood, painted white about 100 years ago, it looked like. It sat kind of crooked, too, like the gravestones, like maybe one end of it had started to sag into the ground. Its windows were twisted and dirty, and a broken red and green neon sign was sort of stuck on top like a big wind had planted it there by accident. It said, Lighthouse Lounge. There was an open-closed sign hanging in front of the front door, but it was flapping around in the heavy wind, so sometimes it showed one side and sometimes the other. The place looked pretty spooky, I gotta say. None of us said a word. And then, swear to God, I saw a shadow pass by one of the windows inside. I looked at the other guys, but nobody was talking. I stared out over the sea. Those three rocks we'd passed before were sitting out there in the distance, way behind the lighthouse, and it made me think of something, but I didn't know what. But then I knew what. I took out the doubloon. It had these three holes cut into it, so I held it up to my eye. The holes lined up exactly with the three rocks and the lighthouse. They were even shaped the same. Not only that, there was an X etched on the coin that seemed to sit right over the lighthouse lounge. I passed the coin around, and everyone had a look. I looked back at the map. It seemed to end right where we were, but it was hard to tell, because this crease ran through that part where it had been bent in on itself for a long time, before it had been framed. I tried to straighten it, but it wouldn't straighten, and that's when I remembered how the doctor had had to break my arm back the other way from the way it was broken in order to straighten it. So I folded the map backward to undo the crease, and that's when I really saw what was what. I saw it worked like a fold-in on the back cover of Mad. And when I folded it in completely on itself, it formed an exact replica of the doubloon, with the holes marked at all the same places, and an X right by the third hole. And when I put the doubloon down over the three signal rocks on the map, the X in the side of the coin exactly laid over the lighthouse. I showed the guys. We're here, I said, pointing to where the little square wooden building was sinking into the sand. This is where the treasure's buried. I indicated the X on the map, and then, once more, pointed toward the lighthouse. Right down there.
End of part 1. This book will be released in segments each week on our YouTube channel, free of charge. However, to help support the costs involved in creating this audiobook, the entire book is available now to our Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book early, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and remember, Goonies never say die.